Retained televangelist Apollo Kibaloy brought to the Philippine Heart Center after complaining of chest pains. A Pasig City court granted a medical furlough for Kibaloy, who had been detained at the National Police Custodial Center since September. A police spokesperson says the pastor was brought to the Heart Center last Friday and was found to have an irregular heartbeat. Kibaloy has been allowed to stay at the hospital until November 16. A court previously denied his plea to be placed under hospital arrest while he faces charges of qualified human trafficking and sexual abuse. The Philippine National Police denies it misplaced millions of pesos seized from two illegal offshore gaming operators. Police spokesperson Brigadier General Jean Fajardo says over 300 million pesos in confiscated cash remain intact in a room at the police headquarters in Kamkrame. The cash was seized from the Clark Sun Valley Hub in Pampanga and Sinchuang Network Technology Incorporated in Las Piñas.
Being heavily secured by the PNP personnel to make sure na makita niyo po yan, puro pera po yung laman yan. This is goes to prove na mali po yung lumalabas na hindi po nawawala po yung mga pera na yan at unaccounted po.
The four subordinates of Philippine Vice President Sara Duterte ordered arrested by a House panel for repeatedly snubbing its inquiry into the expenses of our office. Katrina Domingo reports.
Please raise your right hand.
Less than half of the nine officials summoned from the office of the Vice President heeded the House of Representatives' subpoena to attend congressional investigations into alleged irregularities in how their agency has been spending its funds. This is why the Committee on Good Government and Public Accountability has moved to cite and contempt and ordered the arrest of those who skipped their fifth hearing.
I move that we cite and contempt these individuals for their continuous defiance to attend the committee hearings on good government. Mga public officials po ito, trabaho po nila yung umaten, dumalo, para may paliwanag kung paano ba nagastos yung ilang mga pondo.
House records showed that its staff tried to serve the subpoena to OVP officials 8 times. 4 attended the inquiry, including the OVP's Director of Financial Services and its chief accountant. But 4 others told lawmakers they cannot attend due to official business outside Metro Manila. Zuleika Lopez, Vice President Sara Duterte's chief of staff, was given a last chance to attend the next hearing before the House orders for her arrest, after she wrote to the committee saying that she is in the United States to care for her ailing aunt.
Worrisome na tong mga excuse letter that as much as I wanted to believe her excuse, no? But I think yung pong aunt niya that is living in the United States can possibly stand on their own, especially the healthcare system of the United States. If we were going to allow this excuse of her, then other resource persons might follow.
Because of the continuous refusal of several OVP officials to participate in the House inquiry, the panel has decided to invite the lawyer who notarized several documents linked to the agency's confidential funds. Before the hearing could continue, the committee expelled OVP Legal Affairs Division Chief Emily Torrentira after she refused to be placed under oath before explaining why she refused to receive the subpoenas sent to the OVP's headquarters in Mandaluyong City. Torrentira asserts she should not be placed under oath as she was not formally invited to be a resource person. Lawmakers used her argument against her by telling her to leave the chamber since she was not invited to the proceedings.
I'd just like to comment on the how you were escorted.
I'm sorry, ma'am, I'm not authorized to make some comment.
After Torrentira's departure, Manila Representative Rolando Valeriano questioned why the OVP's fund for gasoline, paper, and other office supplies increased by nearly 500% between 2022 and 2023. Records showed the OVP supplies and materials expenses ballooned to 272.23 million pesos in 2023, over 5 times higher than its 45.82 million peso fund for the said items in 2022. Valeriano also flagged how the OVP's allocation for professional services, or its payment for auditors, consultants, and drivers of its Libreng Sakay program, increased by over 300%, while the OVP's so-called representation expenses more than doubled in a year.
This increase in supplies and materials expenses is extremely alarming. Gumastos na mahigit 44 million ng OVP sa other professional services na hindi man lang pinangalanan ng OVP. Nakakaduda ito. Public office is public trust. Holding a seat in government, the second most powerful in the country to be exact, is not a golden ticket to spend mindlessly.
OVP officials explained that the agency incurred more expenses after it opened 10 satellite offices in different provinces and an extension office in Manila. Data from the OVP showed that the agency spent over a billion pesos in 2023 to run these satellite and extension offices for just 1 year. While the OVP's different programs extended through its nationwide offices have benefited over 977,000 individuals in 2023, lawmakers still pushed to further scrutinize the agency's spending system. They note that despite spending a billion pesos for the operations of these satellite and extension offices, one branch was still looted earlier this year. In a press conference on Monday, the vice president defended the travel orders issued to her personnel. She explains most OVP staff are traveling around the country to prepare for their 89th anniversary on November 15, while other staff were deployed to the OVP's satellite offices to prepare for potential typhoons.
Walang mali siya yan. Meron kaming OVP anniversary sa November, 89th anniversary sa November 15. Lahat kami, tulad kami ni JC, nandito kami ngayon to discuss OVP anniversary for Panay and Negros Island. So, merong isa pumunta ng Cebu at merong isa, his trip was not for a anniversary. Ang trip niya is to Caraga preparing for possible typhoon sa December kasi usually Mindanao, December yung bagyo sa Mindanao. Experience namin doon.
When asked if she would attend the hearings, if invited, here's what she said.
Pag-iisipan ko, ma'am. Pag gusto kong makipag-away, siguro, atan ako ba? Pero sa ngayon kasi sabi ko kay JC, parang sa January na lang makipag-away kasi nga sobrang busy talaga yung Thanksgiving ng 89th anniversary.
Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. assures the public government is ready to address the potential impact of three storms hitting the country this week. He says aid and essential equipment have already been pre-positioned to support communities affected by Typhoon Nika in northern Luzon. But he admits more preparation is needed due to the threat of multiple storms.
The problem is there is another one that's now 3,000 plus kilometers off the coast of Luzon. And that promises to be a stronger one. So we just have to continue to prepare. We don't have a textbook to follow. We don't have a template to follow. It is climate change and it is the new reality that we are having to face.
Marcos adds rebuilding areas devastated by recent storms is challenging. The trio of storms that recently hit the Philippines killed at least 159 and displaced thousands more. The scale of damage caused by Nika is still unclear.
Ngayon, sinasabi natin, mag-isip-isip tayo kasi kung aayusin natin, tapos sisirain na naman ang susunod na bagyo, sayang lang yung ating ginawa, so kailangan natin magplano. Pero yung mga tao, kailangan na may kuryente, kailangan na may food supply, kailangan na may tubig, kailangan na ayusin ang kanilang bahay. So this is the balance that we are, this is the tightrope that we are trying to navigate.
President Marcos shrugs off China's reaction to the signing of twin laws that define the maritime rights and entitlements of the Philippines. China opposed the enactment of the Philippine Maritime Zones Law and Archipelagic Sea Lanes Law. It even summoned Manila's ambassador to Beijing, Jaime Flores Cruz, to protest the measures.
It's not unexpected, but we have to define closely. Marami tayong sinasabi that we have to protect our sovereign rights and our sovereignty. So it serves a purpose that we define closely what those boundaries are.